Hello friends, let's understand what are the key technical drivers or technology drivers that are driving the growth of FinTech. And will these technology drivers continue to drive the growth the way they have done in the past? And what is the benefit of understanding these technology drivers when it comes to FinTech? As we know, the conventional wisdom is that business drives the technology. Typically in an organization, the customer requirements drive business. The business wants to provide better and better services to the customer, hence they drive technology in order to help them do that. However, in last few decades, the technology evolution or revolution has happened with such great extent that now technology is driving the business in a big way. Therefore, the legacy players in many industries are lagging, whereas, for example, in finance, the fintech players are surging or thriving. So what are the key technology drivers driving fintech? Number one, big data, which comes with social or unstructured data. Number two, analytics, and specifically predictive analytics. Number three, Internet of Things or IoT, and with that, mobility. Number four, cloud. Number five, APIs or application programming interfaces. Number six, no code or low code solutions. Number seven, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Number eight, open source technologies. Number nine, software as a service, platform as a service, banking as a service kind of technology delivery models. Number 10, cybersecurity. And number 11, blockchain. Let's understand each of these in detail and how they are impacting FinTech. First one, big data. Big data is many times associated with evolution of social media, because big data is supposed to handle both structured or database relation management system driven data as well as unstructured data. For example, somebody's comment on Facebook. The big data technology should be able to handle big volume of data, a data which has high velocity or rate of change, and also a data that has a lot of variety. All this is being used successfully for things like customer profiling and segmentation, providing of microfinance or nanofinance services, credit scoring of the customer within seconds, making mobile payments, and also for fraud detection and prevention for online transaction, which has to happen in a millionth of a second. The second one is analytics, and in specific the predictive analytics, the higher order of analytics, because it helps you predict future outcomes and accordingly take steps to drive the outcomes the way you want. For example, doing customer analytics to help custom process the transactions faster, cheaper, and with lot of ease, because that is going to improve the customer experience and they are going to become loyal to you. Also, this analytics is being used to prevent cyber fraud and many other kind of online frauds, manage risk, report different kind of trends that are happening, and also for forecasting revenue, because revenue forecasting will help you manage your expenses and valuations better. Number three, the IoT or Internet of Things, and in specific around mobile devices, is something that is helping FinTech grow quite a lot. A lot of surveys have indicated that over 70% of finance users use mobile access for basic inquiries like their account balance and their transactions, the payments they have made in the past, etc. And if you can provide them, let's say using an app, then you are increasing their productivity quite a lot and the customer experience is really improving a lot, which means the customer will be happy to work with you. They are also being used, for example, for fraud analytics and for providing device-based security, because there is something called BYOD, bring your own devices in the organization environment also, but they need to be secure. The point of sales systems are, that are helping the customer pay with, let's say, credit card or debit card at the merchant. Also, cardless systems or contactless systems, they're also coming up in a big way. There's a BNPL, buy now, pay later model, which is very much, being used by a lot of retailers and other players. But of course, a lot of questions are there around that. Is it something that will, lead to a lot of crisis as well because of the credit credit is not being done properly, assessment not being done properly. Micro lending is being done. The Internet of Things are being used, for example, for smart contracts using blockchain. You can get a custom life insurance or a general insurance, for example, with a chip embedded in your car. You can, you know, your sort of driving behavior is assessed by the insurance company, and accordingly, they can design a custom insurance for you. Likewise, based on your health parameters that a device can detect, you might get a good insurance quote also, life insurance quote or health insurance quote. It is being used in things like, you know, smart wallet, for example, a dedicated smart wallet for, let's say, a particular device, you know, that you can set limit on, and then accordingly the you can, you know, use those devices. So IoT and mobility is driving a lot of change in fintech. The cloud services have continued to evolve. You know, big players like Amazon Web Services, Microsoft Azure, etc., they have implemented a lot of best practices. There was a lot of resistance from fintech or finance players around usage of cloud because your data is in the cloud, and, you know, privacy is biggest concern in the financial services. Like in many other industries, but in financial services and healthcare, it's a very big concern. So best practices like the encryption of data while storing and then decryption while delivering, the access control, you know, user-based access control, etc., the compliance around the laws of different countries, the segregation of data while storing, and then disaster recovery, etc., have helped the cloud services gain popularity in financial technology or fintech as well. And this is being ostensibly now in the sales service applications, managing big data, for example, the unstructured data, and it is helping fintechs grow with the kind of flexibility because, you know, your storage cost, etc., will increase as your transactions increase. And it is scalable also model because, you know, you just simply have to, you know, keep adding the data, and the Amazon or other services can, you know, sort of increase the availability of space or the processing for you. And you can be very agile and innovative because you are using cloud, and then, you know, overall you can save your cost because whatever investment you have to go in upfront setting up the entire infrastructure, now it gets into variable cost. Fifth important thing that is driving fintech on the technology side is the, you know, sort of popularity of APIs or application programming interfaces, which help exchange lot of data, financial data like banking data, securities transaction data, pensions, insurance, tax, etc., with various parties in a very secured, efficient, low cost and scalable way, and it is based on consent. If I give my consent, then only the data can be accessed. Consent can be given for a specific period of time, only for a specific transaction, and it can be revoked. So that, you know, makes it very easy for us to share the data with different players and, you know, use that data to improve the quality of service that we want. This is getting into things like, for example, the open banking, for example, banking as a service. There are a lot of data aggregation players that are, you know, sort of leveraging this data to provide better sort of customer experience, and they are being used in various domains like payments, financing or lending, investments, insurance, trading, and in blockchain they are being deployed in, let's say, trade finance, cryptocurrency, and also being used for risk management, know your customer, the analytics of fraud, etc., etc. The sixth important technology change that is driving fintech is the no code or low code solutions. So you don't need to have extensive, you know, programming knowledge. If you understand the basics, your logic is good, there are no code solutions that are automatically writing the codes now, right? So but there are, this is coming up because of a lot of challenges that the fintech players and even others are facing. For example, the outdated technology that, you know, sort of cannot keep up with the evolving customer needs, the compliance cost of maintaining an extensive code, and the budget constraints. So benefits of low cost or no cost solutions are fairly obvious. They are speed, flexibility of designing solutions, simplicity of, you know, sort of creating code, efficiency of writing code, and relatively low cost, as well as democratization of the entire, you know, coding process, because, you know, now we have more people who are not essentially sort of high-tech programmers. But there are risks with these new no-code, low-code kind of solutions because, you know, you need to have better governance, risk and compliance around that, because, you know, the development model followed may not be that robust. Skills availability is still a, you know, sort of challenge because, you know, these solutions also have a certain degree of adaptability that is required. And then the legacy sort of, you know, technology experts will, you know, sort of push back on these kind of solutions, right? So there's still time to these becoming very, very popular in fintech, but I'm sure with time they might become very popular. The next driver on the technology side has been artificial intelligence and machine learning. So these reflect in the form of algorithms that are written, you know, which sort of try, the machines try to predict, you know, act human behavior and also learn from what they do, right? So they learn from data. So things like artificial neural networks that, you know, use different kind of evolving logic. deep learning algorithms that help you the sentiment analysis, for example, or personalize the experience for the customer. And there are various use cases for AI and ML in financial services. A number of them are getting implemented, for example, in real-time decision making, for example, in the chatbots, which help customer, you know, with their queries and solve their problems, in know your customer, anti-money laundering, fraud detection, on trading side, for example, there are trading algorithms, you know, which help you take the decision. On investing side, we have robo advisors, you know, which help you take the decisions. And one on the insurance side, for example, to pick up the right kind of insurance for us. There are risks on the AIML side also that fintech players have to take care of. For example, the security itself, you know, about the access of data, data privacy, there being no human judgment involved. For example, there have been stock market crashes because of the algorithms. And then also we know now, for example, because these are data driven kind of models where machine learn from the data, there could be a bias built into the data that might prove to be harmful for you. The eighth important, you know, sort of technology change that is driving fintech is the open source. So as we know, open source are those organizations which, you know, give out sort of code and other tools for free, right, and which help you, you know, sort of drive down your cost and also use technologies that are very, very popular. For example, the leading technologies in this space are like Java, for example, Python, C++, which are open source in nature that drive down the organization's cost extensively. Many organizations are now okay with the use of open source technologies. There was a lot of concern about one or two decades back as open source was growing, specifically in the finance domain. But now code contributions from finance domain to GitHub, you know, kind of open source code repositories are increasing. And there are security, of course, concerns which are there, but they are relatively sort of getting diluted now. And, you know, people are looking more at productivity, fast go-to market, right? Lower cost, availability of large diversified, you know, pool of people with that skill set, and de-risking of the vendors kind of benefits from the open source system. So more and more organizations are using open source now. As I said, you know, Python is extensively used in financial services. C++ is extensively used in financial services, as along with Java. The ninth tech driver for fintech has been the evolution of SaaS, software as a service, platform as a service, banking as a service kind of technology delivery models. And these are in various areas. For example, in banking, core banking, for example, you can get bank in a box kind of a solution. In lending, for example, you can get in cards processing. In insurance, you know, for example, online application processing, customer service. In payments, then the entire value chain, I think, is now, you know, extensively productized and in the sort of, you know, being sort of dominated by the fintech players. Trading areas, you have a lot of scope through software as a service kind of models, risk management, compliance, KYC, AML, fraud, and all these are, you know, sort of getting delivered in a software as a service as a kind of a model. The benefits of SaaS or, you know, software as a service, platform as a service kind of models is fairly obvious. They are accessible very easily, you know, over the internet. They are available. The availability standards that are being expected and delivered are quite high. And there's a lot of cost saving, of course. You don't have to put up a lot of upfront cost. There's, you know, relatively less upfront cost, but of course, there's a variable cost that you have to incur. No internal resources are many times required for developing and maintaining these extensive applications. The compliance is many times, you know, taken care of by these players because, you know, they have to design a product which takes care of these requirements. Ready integrations are available with, you know, many leading players through APIs. Feature updates are delivered automatically and without incurring much of a cost. The inherently scalable applications, because many of them sort of, you know, leverage cloud in the back end. They emphasize a lot on the security of data, on the privacy, on things like, you know, business continuity plan, disaster recovery plan, etc. And they provide the ability to the fintechs to have a lower cost of acquisition of customers and also, you know, increase or sort of have a higher a lifetime value of the customer. So SaaS is becoming, you know, very, very popular and is driving fintech in a big way. The 10th driver of fintech has been all these things around cybersecurity, because financial services are the key target for the criminals and cyber criminals. Like, they use things like ransomware to, you know, sort of encrypt your data and maybe demand a ransom through, let's say, bitcoins, right? Because that is where, you know, you cannot trace the identity of the, you know, sort of people who are doing this kind of a thing. Then hacking is very popular, you know, sort of phishing, for example, where somebody, who is a criminal, he poses like a bank, right? So they take you to a website which looks like a bank, and then they capture your, you know, for example, the password and user ID. So data integrity, etc. These kind of things is what are concerns around the cybersecurity area. But a lot of measures that the cybersecurity, you know, tools providers or the vendors have taken, like for example, helping the legacy application refresh to take care of the challenges of loopholes in, you know, interface between new age applications and legacy applications, following the DevOps kind of model. In machine learning to, you know, sort of, or predictive analytics to predict behavior of these kind of criminals, using third party security kind of tools, implementing better access control, and, you know, implementing better endpoint security. So these kind of things have helped improve the cybersecurity aspects better, and fintechs are, you know, sort of benefiting from that. The last and I think important thing on the technology side that has helped fintechs in a big way is the evolution of blockchain or distributed general ledger technology, where basically the data is distributed and stored virtually across the web with multiple copies of the data. So what happens is the storage is virtual, driving down the storage cost. But of course, blockchain also comes with its own cost, for example, of data mining, etc., you know, which are tremendously high, specifically on the energy consumption side. But the data has inbuilt redundancy. So that's why, you know, some people are preferring that, and also there's a integrity of the data ensured, because you cannot change the data once you write it using the distributed general ledger or blockchain kind of a technology. Because if you make the change has to be authenticated by a large number of, you know, computers on the network, which is not going to happen unless they are convinced about it. There are a lot of use cases for application of blockchain in the area of finance, like for example in trade finance, writing of LCs, for example, issuing blank bank guarantees, making cross-border payments, tokenizing the assets, for example, your credit cards, or, you know, many of that data which you can tokenize and use it, and, you know, store use it for a limited period of time and still provide sort of protect your credit card numbers, as an example, right? Making sure that the compliance is there, making sure that the digital identity is, you know, protected. For example, because if you are using blockchain, then only your public key you need to share with people, whereas your private key remains with you, and maybe it is attached to a specific device. The smart contracts using blockchain are being implemented, and of course one of the biggest applications of blockchain has been cryptocurrency, which is very much discussed, but I think there are many applications beyond that which slowly the financial services players are taking up and will be extensively using. So these are the technology trends that are driving fintech in big time. So helping them understand will help you identify what kind of, you know, technology skills that I need to acquire if I want to be doing a career in, you know, sort of fintech. So for example, is it AI, ML, is it, you know, cloud technologies, or, you know, around blockchain and so on and so forth. So if you identify these well, then you can lock into a good career which is, you know, having a good growth for, let's say, next 5 to 10 years, acquire the necessary skills and knowledge, right? So that will help you a lot. So hope you found this video very interesting and useful. If yes, please do like this video, share with your friends who will find this useful, and also please do subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much. Take care. Cheers.